Yesterday, I experienced a very, what I would consider a, I had a dull experience. I had to sit through, or I had to, literally, I had to stand through an exciting award ceremony. It was an event, I mean, the people who actually got the award, it wasn't me, the individuals who got the awards, it was well deserved, but the big thing was that the awards were given out by, it was supposed to be by somebody on the general staff over at the Air Force Base, but it turned out to be one of the senior civilians, an SES. And, you know, it's interesting when you deal with senior executives or general staff members, there is a very serious protocol that goes along with it. I frequently have heard people say, attention on deck, or officer on deck, and that basically tells you, stand up. Somebody who is a VIP, somebody who has great authority or power, is entering the room, and it's a very serious sign of respect. You also are to be decently dressed when you're in the presence of somebody who's a VIP. And additionally, and probably the most important thing, was you always show up early. We were told to show up at 9:10, and the senior executive didn't show up to the awards ceremony. Oh, crud, it was almost 30 minutes, or it was 9:30. So we stood around in the lobby, packed in like sardines, for almost 30 minutes. I even have an experience, too, a couple years prior to that, that we actually had a Georgia State representative that came in and wanted to tour the building. So they set up little engineering stations for people to tour, and they would potentially walk by, and you would talk to them for about 30 seconds. So they said, Tom, stand there. They might come by. No kidding. I got dressed up. I had my suit and tie on. The individual never came by. I think I sat there for two, I stood there for 2 hours waiting for the individual. But the bottom line is you must be waiting when the VIP or the staff officer or flag officer comes through. It is a pure sign of respect. But for an individual like me, I'm impatient. Waiting for me is generally, not generally, it is very difficult, very boring. I usually equate it with very negative experiences. Like, how about going to the grocery store? Even in the express line, I always seem to get stuck behind the person who can't find their cash or wants to use one of these stupid coupons that's expired, or they want to write a check. Who writes checks anymore? Here's another one, red lights. I'm in a hurry to go pick up Jason from school, and you know what? I hit every red light in the little town of Warden Robins, and I think there were maybe five of them, and I hit them all. The waiting in traffic. And you know, the other one that I keep thinking about that really irks me is when we're at a fast food place like Chick-fil-A, and there's got a big long line, they've got the menu up on the screen, and the person in front of me walks up and puts their hands in her pockets and figures, wow, now what do I want? I don't know. They're really not deciding. You know, you're standing in line. Look, read the menu. Be ready. Be prepared. I'm impatient. I'm waiting my turn too. But anyway, waiting is generally, though, just like the experiences I described, is generally associated with a very passive activity. It can be boring, and usually it's a case like if you sit in a class or you have to listen to somebody like me, you're probably watching the clock waiting when I'm going to sit down. It's dull. People fidget with their phones when they're bored and when they're waiting. But the thing that I find kind of ironic is how many times in the scripture does God actually say, wait on the Lord. So basically, it's a command. And he's telling us to wait on the Lord. So is it a boring activity? The answer is obviously not. The command to wait on the Lord is a very, very important part of our spiritual life or our spiritual relationship with the Lord. So let's start And we'll discuss waiting, in particular, waiting for the Lord, or waiting on the Lord, or there's various expressions that's used, and I haven't counted how many times it's given to us. But let's start by turning over to Psalm 37. Here's a very, very famous scripture. Psalm 37, and we'll start in verse 7. It says, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It only causes harm." And let's jump down to 34. "Wait again on the Lord and keep his ways, and he shall exalt you to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, you shall see it." Here in verse 34, it equates with waiting on the Lord with keeping the Lord's commands. Now, the one thing, let's start here by defining what the term wait is. We all kind of conceptually know what it is, but according to my Webster's dictionary, it says stay, or it's defined as stay in one place, remaining in expectation of something, and emphasizes be prepared. So for the rest of my time here, this is what I'd like to emphasize, and I'd like to keep in mind. Waiting is actually not just spending time standing around. Waiting implies being prepared. Now, first of all, before we move on, waiting in particular with somebody like a VIP is a very serious sign of respect, showing up ahead of time. He said they told us at that award ceremony yesterday to show up 20 minutes ahead of time and wait around. So when the senior executive came in, we weren't wasting their time. Now, if you also think about it, does anyone ever go to the movies late? No, for two reasons. One, you don't want to miss the show. You don't want to miss the beginning. But secondly, you don't want to be disrespectful climbing over the people that are there waiting to watch. 2 weeks from now, we're going to be keeping the Passover. We would not be allowed in if you showed up late. But more importantly, it would show as a sign of total disrespect to the Lord if one showed up late. It's a total sign of being there on time is a show of respect. Now let's turn over to Matthew 24. Matthew 24 and in verse 46. Again, with the emphasis on waiting and being prepared. "Blessed is the servant whom his master, when he comes, finds himself so doing." And in verse 48, "But if the evil servant says in his heart, 'My master is delaying his coming,' and begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and to drink with drunkenness, the master of that servant will come on that day when he is not looking for him, and at an hour that he is not aware of. And will cut him in two and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth." We are to be ready. Are waiting. We've been waiting a long time. I've been attending church for almost 50 years now. I was just a little kid, and I was expecting the age to come in 1975. And that came and went years and years ago. But the key is be prepared. Well, now that begs the question. That begs a very, very serious question, especially for somebody like me. How do I wait on the Lord when I'm so inherently impatient? It's a tough one. It's a tough one for me. Well, I have a couple points on how I think it would help us to be patient and wait on the Lord. How I need to wait on the Lord. Okay, for the first thing, the first point is you always must acknowledge that God's sovereign has sovereign control over all things. Now that term sovereign, it's kind of, I don't want to use the term archaic, but it's a word. When was the last time you used sovereign in a sentence? I mean, other than here in church or in a religious context, we never use that term sovereign. It's a very valid term. But so I looked it up, so we're all on the same page. But sovereign, according to dictionary.com, it basically says having supreme rank, power, or authority. So when we talk about God being supreme, in my modern day worded or usage, what does that mean? That means the Lord is in charge and he can do whatever he likes. It doesn't matter. He's in charge, and nothing, by the way, happens, and this is all we know, nothing, absolutely nothing happens against his will. So let's go turn over to John 10. John 10. And in verse 17. John 10. This is important, especially in context of Passover. John 10 and verse 17. Therefore, my Father loves me because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. So what is he telling us? He's telling us something very important. He is choosing. He has chosen to sacrifice himself for our sins. My sinful life did not force Christ to die. Did not. He did it, as John 10 says, he did it out of choice and out of love for us. Now, the Bible is full of scriptures that talk about the sovereignty of the Lord. And I'll tell you, whenever I read them, I do get chills. But one of my favorites, by the way, let's jump to Daniel 4. Daniel 4. And in verse 17, this was Nebuchadnezzar's second dream. And in verse 17, Daniel gives him the interpretation, Nebuchadnezzar, the interpretation of the dream. And it says in verse 17, this is the decision by the decree of the watchers and the sentence by the word of the holy ones, in order that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdoms of men. He gives it to whomever he will, and sets over it the lowest of men. And of course, we know the story. Nebuchadnezzar became a wild beast for 7 years. And in jumping down in verse 34, and at the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my understanding returned to me, and I blessed the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? And let's turn to Job. I mean, I really do enjoy Job. And in that one, I find it absolutely amazing to know the scripture. I mean, I could go on and on about scriptures with the sovereignty of the Lord. But the one I find kind of interesting, in Job 1, and in verse 8, then the Lord said to Satan, Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil? So Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? And in verse 11, God says to Satan, but now stretch out your hand and touch all this that he has, and he will surely curse you to his face. That was Satan talking. In verse 12, Lord says to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power, only do not lay hand on his power. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Bottom line, who ruled? Satan is our ultimate adversary. But who ruled Satan? Satan had to obey. Now to the next one. The next point, point number two. We have to come to the terms that all of our dependency is on the Lord. That one's a real tough one for me because I really like to be in control of my life. It's really, really hard. I like to have the answers to everything. I like to have, if I don't have a plan A, I have a plan B. And if I don't have a plan B, then I have a plan C. Life doesn't work that way. An interesting experience I had a number of years ago was the government, not that it's doing much better now, but the federal employees were subject to a furlough. I cannot begin to express the amount of stress that I went through from a financial perspective. I went days thinking, how in the world am I going to support the family that God gave me? How am I going to do this? And you know, my loving wife said, fast about it. And you know, I did. I fasted on a Sabbath. And it was right in the middle of the fast that we got the word that the furlough was lifted. It was submission to the Lord. And finally coming to the, it was very difficult for me to come to the conclusion that I have to depend on the Lord. For some of us, it's easier than others. But you know what? In Matthew 5, this is something that we should be praying about every single day. Matthew 5 and verse 5. Oh, I'm sorry, Matthew 5 and verse 9. This is the... Matthew 6. I got the wrong verse. Matthew 6 and verse 9. In this manner, therefore pray, O Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here we're actually acknowledging, Lord, you're in charge. And in verse 11, we pray, give us this day our daily bread. Provide everything for us. And another one, First Chronicles. This one seems like an odd place to go, but it's one of my favorite scriptures. 2 Chronicles 16. And this has to do with the prophet coming to King Asa before he got his foot diseased. Now in 2 Chronicles 16 and in verse 8, the prophet came to King Asa and chided him from the Lord. And he says, were the Ethiopians and the Lubin not a huge army with every manner of chariots and horsemen? Yet, because you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. And here the kicker in verse 9. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. In this you have done foolishly, therefore now on you shall have wars. He will provide. We have to remember that he will always be our provider. Point number three, be patient and be quiet. That's a tough one, especially for somebody, an extrovert like me, who sometimes just can't shut up. But it's also difficult now, especially since we're coming up on Passover. is life getting busier now through Passover? I have to say, yeah. For at least for me, it is. We're running all over the countryside, you know, attending events. Work is chaotic and busy. What else? Oh yeah, my fence just broke, and so I have to take care of that. Let's see, and the list can go on and on. Oh yeah, and then the Russians invaded Ukraine. Gas prices are going up. Everything is whirling. There's so much busyness. Do you know what it is? It's Satan's chaotic way of distracting us on what is absolutely important. So what does the Lord tell us to do? Psalm 62. Psalm 62. If you're ever discouraged, please read the Psalms. Psalm 62. And in verse 5. My soul, wait silently, you know, for God alone. For my expectation is from Him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be removed. In verse 8, trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge to us. And one of the perfect, best stories of the silence that we should have is in the book of Exodus. In the book of Exodus, in chapter 14, and the crossing of the Red Sea. I love this story. Out of all the miracles that we've heard throughout there, that we read through in the Bible, I would have loved to be a fly on the wall for, you know, for this one. But in Exodus 14, we know the story, because the Israelites are caught up against the Red Sea, and Pharaoh's chasing them down, and they're complaining. In verse 12, is this not the word that we told you in Egypt, saying, let us alone? The Israelites wanted to be alone, left alone in their sins. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, do not be afraid, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which He will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians who you see today, you shall see again no more forever. And the key here, verse 14, the Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Do you know what you shall hold your peace is another word of saying? Shut up. Sounds kind of harsh. Stop complaining and sit there and be quiet. You know, we listen to messages about fasting, but I will tell you, there is nothing better in the planet to quieting your mind and quieting your spirit than fasting. Is there? It forces us to acknowledge the Lord. It forces us to pay attention and wait. Now, point four. We must prepare ourselves, or be constantly preparing ourselves spiritually. We hear messages on that all the time, examining ourselves before Passover. But in Matthew 24, we're going to read a couple of verses from Matthew 24 and Matthew 25. And in Matthew 24 and in verse 36. But of that day and the hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of man be. And then verse 42, watch therefore, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house, us, had known that, you know, what hour the thief would have come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, be ready. I went back to, what is waiting? Waiting implies be prepared. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. Now it moves on in, by the way, and to Matthew 25 and the parable of the 10 virgins. I'd like to point something else out here. Matthew 25 and verse 1. The kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise, and 5 of them were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with the lamp. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. Now my point here is, we always are used to hearing about how, oh, the bridegrooms or the virgins, they were all sleeping. Woe to them. Well, I'd like to emphasize the fact that it calls 5 wise, and it emphasized 5 of them were wise and 5 of them were foolish. What was the difference between the two? The 5 that were wise were prepared. They were ready. So when the call went out, they were ready to go. Absolutely ready to go. And I'm not saying it was immaterial that they were asleep. Should we be asleep? No. But what I'm just saying is, they were prepared for the return of the bridegroom. And my last point, and this one is very important because it's also a very big state of mind. The last point, expect the Lord to save or provide. Expect it. Genesis 49. There's an interesting little verse here. It's a in the prophecies about the tribes of Israel in the end time. But as Genesis 49 and in verse 18, this is talking about Dan. But the point applies. In verse 18, I have waited for your salvation, O Lord. They expected it. In this reverse, Dan was expecting the salvation of the Lord. You know, the furlough was outside my control. Was I hoping the Lord would take care of it? Yeah, I would. But I was it was a little stressful for me. But you know, the funny thing is, all the years I was single, I expected the Lord to provide me a wife. I didn't get married till my mid-30s. And I tell you what, it was a little bit trying of my spiritual patience. But I will tell you, I did expect God to bring me a bride. But it wasn't for the lack of my trying. I tried and I tried. The ones that I could have picked, I didn't. But the ones that I should have picked, those are the ones I did. And everything kind of went, ugh. But it wasn't what the Lord wanted. He provided in a way that I did not expect. And that parallels the story we're all very familiar with in Genesis 15. Genesis 15 and in verse 1. And after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham and in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, exceeding great, your exceeding great reward. And in verse 4, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be the heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. And in verse 6, and he believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness. And we all know Isaac was the son of promise, but did Abraham take things into his own hands? Yes, he did. Down in verse 16, chapter 16, now Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she said to an Egyptian maidservant whose name was Hagar. So Sarah said to Abram, see now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go into my maid. Perhaps I shall obtain children by her. And Abram heeded the voice of Sarai. Foolish, foolish man. Don't ever, ever do that. That is very, very dumb. But he took things into his own hands, didn't follow the way of the Lord, didn't wait on the Lord in this particular account. And you see, now we're dealing with the consequences from that to this day. So are there things that we can actually do to help us wait on the Lord? Yes. We have to, first of all, I think the most important ones, they all count, but important to me at least, acknowledge that the Lord is in charge. Absolutely, with no exceptions. And secondly, expect the Lord to save or provide. So being the natural impatient person that I am, knowing all this doesn't make waiting on the Lord any easier. I'm just not a patient person. But with Passover 2 weeks away, but Passover in just 2 weeks is the perfect time to slow down and to focus on the ultimate sacrifice that Christ made on our behalf. Now, to close it, I would like to go to a very inspiring scripture. Let's turn to the book of Lamentations. Yeah, sandwiched between Jeremiah and Ezekiel. Lamentations. Lamentations, chapter 3. And we'll start in verse 21. This I recall to my mind. Therefore, I have hope. Therefore, or through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Verse 25, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man to bear the yoke in his youth.